Terry Riken, your broker with a personal touch, proudly presents Ken Boxer Live.
Hi, Keith Coogan. We're on Ken Boxer Live on TVSB.
From the American Riviera in Santa Barbara, California, it's Ken Boxer Live, Santa Barbara's one and only entertainment talk show. Let's welcome the host of the show, Ken Boxer.
You're all very kind. Thank you. I'm Ken Boxer. This is Ken Boxer Live. Let me introduce you to my guest co-host, Silvana Smud. Give it up, everybody. Good to see you, Silvana. Introduce yourself to our great audience.
Hi, I'm Silvana Smud. It's so exciting to be here. Ken was asking me what I've been up to, and I had to tell him I was on this wonderful vacation in Europe. I did Spain and Italy. Not too bad, for 3 weeks, so a little bit of post-vacation blues.
One of the nice things, though, is when you're vacationing, you get to come back to Santa Barbara, right?
Exactly, and then I come to beautiful Santa Barbara, and we're so excited for our guest today.
Who do we have on?
Well, I'm going to tell you, he is not only the grandson of a legendary actor, Jackie Coogan, but we've seen him in movies, A Book of Love, Don't Tell Mom the Babysitter's Dead, lots of TV shows, Mork and Mindy, The Love Boat, The Waltons, lots of shows. And stay tuned, we'll be right back with Keith Coogan.
Ken Boxer Live, brought to you in part by The Eagle Inn, a family-owned hotel near the beach in Santa Barbara. Harborview Inn. Welcome to Santa Barbara's premier four-diamond luxury boutique oceanfront hotel. La Quinta Inn and Suites, conveniently located in downtown Santa Barbara. Now back to Ken Boxer Live.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. And we are back. Joining us tonight is the television, stage, and film actor Keith Coogan. Keith is best remembered for his starring roles in such classic films as The Adventures in Babysitting, Cousins, and Don't Tell Mom the Babysitter's Dead. Now let's welcome the very busy Keith Coogan, everybody. Welcome.
Well, thank you for having me on the show.
And this is not the first time you've been in Santa Barbara.
No. Well, we had my wife and I, Pinky, we take our anniversaries usually in Central Coast, Pismo Beach. And one year we're driving through Santa Barbara, and I had the bright idea to take my wife, who's afraid of windy roads. Or small windy hills up mountains to the Chumash Caves. And that was really smart. So after, I'm like, get a good look around because we're never coming back, she said. And we got down safely. But that was, Santa Barbara was beautiful. Thank you for
that windy road. Dangerous windy road to get up there.
It's terrible. Terrible. Now I know why the Chumash were like, I'm staying up here. I'm not even going back down again.
When did the bug hit you for acting? You've been in the business a long time. You started early on?
I was four. We were living, my mom and I were living up in Sacramento. She was studying psychology at American River College, and I was in preschool. And I really loved watching Sesame Street and Electric Company and Via Alegre and Mr. Rogers. And anytime I saw kids on those shows, I was like, those kids look like they're having a lot of fun. They really do. I want to be one of those kids. But I said the magic words, what my mom heard. And my mom is like, you know, before that choice that I made or whatever, she was really Jackie Coogan's daughter. And my mom has her own, you know, things that she's had to deal with that growing up with her father. So when I said, I want to act, I want to be on TV, those are the magic words. I want to be on TV. We were down the five as fast as you could get here. And instead of a place in the valley that was, she saw a place in Malibu for the same amount as it would be in the, and so we moved into Malibu in 1975.
Right.
And I got my SAG card in 76.
But your mother looks at a four-year-old and says, I'm going to take your word, let's get to L.A.?
Absolutely. I could read, and she knew that it could be very exploitive, the industry for a child actor. But she also knew that if there's any parent that is wise about that, it would be Jackie Coogan's daughter. She's like, I'll watch the money, I'll watch him on the set. He's never leaving my sight and sound. It's the SAG rules, and it's labor rules. A minor parent can always be present. And like, never someone can take him off to another room. We're going to take him to a second location. So my mom knew that if you're going to do this, and she knew it could be a dangerous industry for a child to be in for many reasons.
But a lot of people won't know this until perhaps right now. Your grandfather, there's a law named after him because he got totally screwed. I mean, that's what happened.
Yeah, he did. Well, there was no, he got screwed by how we would think now, because we do pay our child actors.
Well, let's first talk about your grandfather, who he was in history of acting.
John Leslie Coogan. They called him Jackie as a child. My great-grandfather, Jack Coogan, we called him Senior. They were in vaudeville. My great-grandfather and great-grandmother Lillian were in vaudeville. And Jack came up on stage at about 4, and it was the night Chaplin was there to see the show in downtown L.A., and he put him in the kid. So my grandfather's Jackie Coogan, the kid in Charlie Chaplin's The Kid. And then he, had a full career of ups and downs, right, and also had the greatest comeback in a career that spanned, half a dozen decades already. He was Uncle Fester in the Addams Family.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I grew up with that show.
I grew up with it too. And John Astin were friends, and I knew Sean and Mackenzie Astin and grew up with them. And I felt like I was, brothers with Sean and Mackenzie, because...
So let's talk about that, which I just described, that your grandfather got, I don't want to say it again.
So, but after the kid, of him. My great-grandfather formed a production company, and they worked for years, even had a $500,000 signing bonus with MGM when they came on board to do about 4 pictures with MGM. A $500,000 signing bonus.
Then,
to an 11-year-old kid.
Then.
He was, this is between 4 and 10 and 11, he'd done maybe 20 different films for Metro and First National, and then finally he signed this MGM contract and did Long Live the King and Oliver Twist and great, huge films. He turned 21, he turned of age. Prior to that, my great-grandfather, who liked to drive fast and drink, they had a ranch down in San Diego, the Coogan Ranch, and they're on their way, and they had a terrible wreck, and everybody in the car died. Junior Durkin, who played Huckleberry Finn to my grandfather's Tom Sawyer, a writer on that film, a ranch hand, and my great-grandfather died in my grandfather's arms. So in the subsequent years, my great-grandmother remarried, and the business manager. And the business manager and my great-grandmother went through the money. When my grandfather turned 21, he said, where's my trust fund? My great-grandfather had promised $1 million trust fund, and my grandfather said, where is it? And they said, you don't get anything. You're a kid. California law is, if you're a minor, 100% of your earnings go to the parent. He sued, he lost. The judge told him at the top of the trial, the law is, it's not your money. So California had an uproar, and very shortly after passed the Coogan Act, which is a California minor labor law, to keep 15% of their money. on the upside, his life wasn't terrible. He had married Betty Grable during this time, and other dancers in Hollywood. And then my grandmother, who was an Earl Carroll girl, and then my mom, and
well, what did
here
he
I am.
Think of, what did Jackie think of you getting into acting?
Oh, he loved it. He's very competitive. My grandfather was very competitive. He taught me how to play chess, and he would get very upset and knock over the board to get iced tea if he was losing. So, I'd be on a show, and he'd be like, that's good. Be like, oh, well, it wasn't like, and he'd tell some grand story of having his car carried through Times Square because the crowds were too large. I'm like, I'm not trying to compete with you. How am I doing? Any notes? No. I'm going up for Tom Sawyer. Like, Disney's doing a version. And I go, Jack, you played the first talkie of Tom Sawyer. Can you give me any notes? And he goes, no. And he goes, make it. He goes, watch your money, and, be careful of mothers. But he would not give me any direction on that. He goes, it's yours to make those choices. So I thought that was neat.
Well, Silvana, you had a question.
I do. So I was looking at your reaction earlier. Someone told you you had a striking resemblance to your grandfather, and you were kind of like, thank you, but which one? Uncle, oh, do you get that a lot?
Am I the grandfather or the balding? Am I Uncle Fester? It's going, but this went at like 18. It's been holding the line for many decades. I'm very happy. I'm old. Rocks don't live that long. I was born in 1970, so I'm 46 years old as of the filming of this show.
Why is it so many young actors, though, have trouble? You know, they're always getting into trouble with the law, or, you know, they're suicidal.
I think anybody that has a really big loss in their life of something that they love, a family member, a career, think about that, you know. A teacher that has tenure and then loses it suddenly. There's a deep hole there, and many times people turn to addiction to fill that hole. And addiction can be, you know, a solace to that, people don't love me anymore. Because that's what you feel as a child. You don't know about the money. You don't know about the career trajectory, and you have to do this, and then a guest appearance, and then a movie of the week, and then your features, and then you don't know billing or size trailer you're supposed to have.
Did you have to study acting?
No. I didn't. I learned on the set. I worked all the time. And one of my first commercials was with Henry Fonda, Viewmaster Viewer commercial. Hanging upside down in a tree, you know, working with Henry Fonda, who's like, can we get out of here? And Jonathan Winters and Robin Williams and, you know, the cast of all these great 70s shows. I picked up and learned from them and my grandparent watching my grandfather work. He was still working as I was working. Right. I got to visit the set of the Addams Family holiday Halloween reunion, and in color, the Addams Family just looked wrong. And shot on video, too. So I got to visit that set, which was really, really neat. Carolyn Jones was still with us, and I just saw a Felix Silla, who played Cousin It, not 8 months ago? At the Disney convention.
Well, let's visit some of your acting. You brought a video with you. What are
we
going to see? What are we going to see right now?
So this is the first clip. If it went chronologically, then this is, I did, my breakthrough was Adventures in Babysitting, but they've chosen a cute clip from Book of Love, which was a film version of Jack Cotswinkle's Jack in the Box. And it was directed by Bob Shea, who's president of New Line Cinema. He also directed The Last Mimsy. He doesn't direct often, and we lost about $3 million on the movie. He would have a party every year. Here's the running tally of how much we've lost on this one.
Well, let's watch Keith
And it's Coogan. Really cute. It's a 50s period piece, but it's a little more Porky's than American Graffiti.
Okay, Keith Coogan, everybody.
Crutch, who's that?
It's Angelo Gabuch and his gang.
Just act natural, and I'll handle everything.
I thought you said you carried a lot of weight around this neighborhood.
Okay, so?
We got de-pantsed. Worst things could happen.
Come on, my house is just around the corner.
That clip is hilarious, but give us a little more insight. What was really going on in this area? I'm sure you did a couple takes.
I mean, I'm young, so at 20, we're like, we got to wear underwear. But also, you know, we're not supposed to have anything on. So I think, there may have been a take with nothing on. Most of the part, I just wore like little tidy whiteys, and I would pull them down way below plumber crack. And let the box dip enough so that viewers would question, is he wearing anything under there at all? Underwear has been part of my career with toy soldiers. A boys' prep school gets taken over by terrorists, and the kids have a problem with authority figures, so they actually overthrow the terrorists. And in that, we have an infamous underwears, many underwear scenes where six prep school kids are held in a room and it's hot and there's no air conditioning and we're all in our underwear. And I get some great message boards, and I have a great fan community in the gay community just because of my character choice. They go, what type? My character is a total wimp, and you know, he's very scary. Other guys are like, I want black boxers. I want black briefs. I want this and that. Speedos. Yeah, and I go, tidy whities. This guy would wear tidy whities, absolutely. And I don't know if it was wrestling with Will Wheaton or whatever, but something I... It looks like I'm packing, so I pictures on the internet, and I celebrate those that love toy soldiers for very curious reasons.
But you're a hot commodity on the tour circuit with the conventions. In fact, you have some coming up. Why don't you give us?
This weekend we're doing Rewind Con. It is celebrating 90s with 90210 and Backstreet Boys and NSYNC and 98 Degrees. And it has got Jeremy Miller and Tracy Gold from, what was that show they were on? Growing Pains, that's it. Uh-huh. So many great stars. It is a 3-day event with a prom launching on Friday night. And then, autographs. We're also going to be at New Year's, which is marvelous Nerd Year's Eve with Stan Lee, who... I'm a huge Spider-Man and Hulk fan and Iron Man fan, so I'm like Stan Lee, oh God. He is my God. And that's New Year's in Dallas. And all that information's on my website and stuff.
So you're busy. What about television? We heard that you were on Mork and Mindy. What was it like working with Robin Williams?
Oh, it was it is in a carnival. And what you do is you are all prepared. And then it's Robin's turn, and you spin the wheel. What's he gonna say? And I have to hand it to Pam Dauber, who kept the even keel, and she had to play the straight man
for
years.
Did he stick to script, or was he extemporaneous?
Was it mostly improv?
It was almost always improv.
Yeah.
Almost entirely. He would barely skip. If he did, it was twice in a row, maybe, and he'd keep just enough to have the story. She was always handling all the exposition, all the story. Let him grab the prop or the other person and go nuts. It was expected. They would literally write in, Robin does a gag with the cup. We don't even know what it is. He's going to spend half a page doing it.
Let's go to another clip.
Oh, yay.
The show's going by too quickly. We want to get this in. Can you give us a lead
into it? This is the movie that I get most quoted. People come up to me and they say, you know, say it. That's it. A fan can come up to me and they go, could you just say it once? And so there's a certain quote in here, and the quote will probably be on my tombstone. This is Don't Tell Mom the Babysitter's Dead with Christina Applegate, and here's a little scene where she's telling me to do the chores.
Okay, let's see. Let's watch.
Kenny, wake up. Kenny, the food that I bought yesterday is already gone.
I was entertaining some friends last night, and we had the munchies.
Look, I am not working to feed your scummy friends, okay?
You're a career woman now. We can afford to be hospitable.
Whatever. Here. Go buy some more food for the kids.
All right, you got paid.
Well, not exactly. It's office money. It's called petty cash. My paycheck's gonna be for like over $1,000. I'll be able to put it back. I gotta go. And I don't want your friends hanging around my house.
Right.
Mow the lawn today, and don't forget to do the dishes, okay? Bye.
I'll do the dishes. Dishes are done, man.
Cleans them down to the shot.
To work with some really great co-stars. Now, do you still keep in touch with them?
And all did the you time. Ever have... We have barbecues, you know.
Did you ever have...
With Elizabeth Shue and Christina Applegate. Yeah,
well, that was my next question. Did you ever have crushes on, you know, you Christina Applegate, Elizabeth Shue?
I
would imagine as a young
teenage boy. Yeah, I mean, I was 17 when I turned 17 on Adventures of Babysitting.
Yeah.
And I had the hugest crush on Elizabeth Shue you could possibly imagine from Karate Kid. And I also shouldn't have seen Link because it was rated R, but I did. And she assured me it was a stunt boobies in Link. And I was like, dang. There's like a monkey that touches her, but she's a monkey researcher or whatever. Anyway, wasn't hers. I was disappointed. Anyway, so I asked her out. I was like, this was a 3-month shoot. I'm all cocky. I'm like, you know, we're going to work together side by side. It's only a 3-year difference. She's like 20. No, she was 23. It's like a 6-year difference. So I go, you know, hey, I take way out to dinner in the hotel in the lobby and everything. And they're like, sir, we demand a jacket. And they put a little jacket on me. And I'm like, so scared and nervous. And I'm like, you know, maybe, you know, we could see each other, see where that goes or whatever. And she laughed in my face. It's the same exact laugh that she has in the movie. And my look of disappointment is the same look of disappointment that
did
I have.
Did it change on the set from that day?
No, but it did help me. And I was just went back to that moment and I was like, I was absolutely bitter and jealous of any man that went anywhere near Elizabeth Shue for the entire shoot. Aww. And I've just put it on film. I mean, anyway, yeah, there's a time where this guy in a Jeep comes to rescue and I'm like, he goes, you go okay? And I'm like, yeah, I'll take care of it, buddy. You can go. I was just very, huge crush on her. And I've been very unfair in my stand-up. I did a stand-up bit last year, and my virgin time doing stand-up, and I was horribly unfair to Elizabeth. It was all jokes, Lisa. It's all jokes. And Christina, I actually had known Christina for years before this. She's a dear friend, like a community of kids in Hollywood right. That kind of all know each other from functions. And she played my sister, so don't be gross.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
What was it like, by the way? What was it like, Keith? To work with Chris Columbus, the director, the popular director. What was that? It was his first
film. It's like Disney gave $10 million to a 10-year-old to direct a movie. He had the enthusiasm and the fun. He believed in the universe. He could talk to anybody. He could talk right to Maya Bruton, who played Sarah, who was 8 or 10 years old when we did it. And so Chris and his knowledge of, he wrote Gremlins, Goonies, and Young Sherlock Holmes. Mm-hmm. Praire was a Spielberg protege. Prior to Adventures in Babysitting, and David Simkins wrote the script, who also wrote Briscoe County Jr. And David is a huge cult writer. Everyone loves David's work. So Babysitting came, and Chris just jumped in. He was one of the kids with us on the trip. You know, and he also knew where to put the camera and what to do with those cranes and trucks and all Amazing. These things that they gave him. And he absolutely delivered. I think it's so slick. And fun, and it has a great journey where, you know, I'll watch it against other, we've done double features at Alamo Drafthouse with other movies.
Well, were you surprised by his success?
I was, and I only attribute it, others have the same kind of tone or whatever that I've done, but I think it was us. We had a lot of rehearsal time together, and we had funding. We got to know each other, and so we got to do stuff that were in character, but it was us. It was me digging into Anthony Rapp. Or my relationship with Elizabeth Shue, which I really shouldn't talk about further. I thought, you know, he was just really good at doing that and bringing the whole thing. He knew he had the whole vision of the whole movie in his head, and Chris Columbus, you know, it was his directorial debut. And I bucked for Harry Potter, but he made a deal that he would use only British actors.
What's it like, by the way?
That's what I say.
You've been in Hollywood so long. What's it like that for you to have to audition? Especially to kids who don't even know your work. It's gotta be tough.
Oh, sometimes. Isn't that? I think isn't I got cocky once, and it was like new kids and student filmmakers, and they're doing this thing. It's about like shrimping in Maine or something, and it's about the competitive, like fries, little restaurants, tourist traps that like fry food. And I come in and I'm all, yeah, you might wanna rewrite that, and this, I don't know, understand that. And I'm like, you know, if you have trouble on the set or you're running short of time, I can help you make the day. And they just watch, they're like, what an ass this guy is. So, yeah.
It's gotta be hard though, scary. Right? I mean, it's like, you've got this great body of work.
Luckily, with the really young ones, they're mostly doing internet or web series or something, and they just go, would you be in this? You don't have to audition. And I think being able to audition, I see as an opportunity to play, because you're not gonna get every role you audition for. So every time you're auditioning, it's an opportunity to play something that you're not gonna be able to play. So there's the time to be the sword and the master and the guy, and you're like, they're never gonna give this to me, so I might as well go all the way with it. I always think it's the job. You approach an audition like that's it, and what you're doing is in the movie. That's how you're prepared you get for an audition. So I even cry more when I don't get them.
Do you psych yourself up before the audition?
You have to, it's like game day. You have a ritual, the bath, and then the thing, and then the wardrobe's laying there, run the lines again. Okay, I got the thing, I gotta leave, and then parking, and of course something comes in the way, walk the dog, or do something, and traffic, and then you lose your mind on the way to the audition. You have to like, regain yourself before you go on the room. Hi. It's so hard. Auditioning is the hardest thing in the world. It is so, because you're selling yourself, and you're selling yourself is the character, in the character. And then there's also this other thing outside of like your past and your career and what how much you could ask them to pay you.
Well, what about the rejections?
Well, it's what's great is it's you just get ghosted. And they've had this term recently, but actors have been experiencing ghosting ever since auditioning or theater has happened. You just hear nothing. People always ask, did you get the part? Did you get the part? Well, it started shooting 5 days ago and I haven't heard anything, so I don't think I got the part.
Probably not.
It's crushing. And then you see it on TV and you're like, oh, that's who they cast, or that's who they cast. Or you see it and they cut the scene out or the part out. You didn't get the part, but they cut it out, and you go, that's because they didn't cast me.
But you have so many wonderful stories and experiences. Have you ever thought about writing a book or putting it all out there?
Oh, I would love to.
You should.
I would love to do it as a primer for adults, parents, and kids that are thinking of coming in the entertainment industry and have questions. How do you get in? What do? How do you handle the money or the people or the predators or whatever? And I'll go, I'll just then can tell stories of my grandfather and me, maybe in parallel, because we both started working at about 5 years old. I would love to, and I wrote the introduction, the chapter, all the chapters, and the first chapter, like the table of contents. So yes, I've actually started on.
So next time we have you on.
I primarily did it as a need to just give parents more information about their rights on a set and what to expect. A kid in chess or in football in school, not every kid's going to get a scholarship for football. So what are they going to do when they don't get that scholarship for football? I just want them to be prepared and have the kids continue their education. My mom wanted to ground me, so she stuck me into public school. So here I'm on a set on the Waltons and then back to public school. Which is, yo, you were on TV last night, thump.
You get grounded that way, right? We only have like about 30 seconds
That's
left.
That's ridiculous.
It is. Went by too quickly. Again, tell us where you're going to be.
We need more time.
Tell us where you're going to be again.
Chicago Rewind Con this weekend, November 11th to the 13th. And then New Year's is Marvelous Nerd Year's Eve with Stan Lee in Dallas.
And people can come up and you'll do the autograph thing, right?
You come up to the autograph. We do selfies. I sell T-shirts. Plates, dishes with dishes are done, man, on them. Come on up to the table. It's a fun time.
Thank you. Thank you so much, everybody. Keith Coogan.
KeithCooganOnline.com. That website, again, is KeithCooganOnline.com.
Well, that's our show for tonight. Don't miss our next show when we have Trapper John, M.D. Well, it stopped clapping. Trapper John, M.D.
Yes.
Gregory Harrison is our guest. So, for Keith Coogan, and George Montalvo, and the entire KBL crew. I'm Ken Boxer. Good night, everybody.
Good crowd.
A very good crowd.
Ken Boxer Live is brought to you by the following sponsors. Terry Riken, your broker with a personal touch for all your real estate needs. Palazzo Restaurant, where people don't leave hungry or thirsty. Harborview Inn, Santa Barbara's premier four-diamond luxury boutique oceanfront hotel. The Eagle Inn, a family-owned hotel near the beach in Santa Barbara. And by Wendy Foster, La Quinta Inn and Suites, Taffy's Pizza, Country Catering, Meat Market and Deli, Lido's Takeout, Jack's Bagels and Bistro, Ice and Paradise, Perfect Computers, The Ken Boxer Live musical themes by Mr. Michael J. Leslie. From all of us at Ken Boxer Live, I'm Baron Ron Heron. Good night, everyone.